Hello, Josie. Welcome to the event by the Media Rumble. Thank you, Media Rumble, for having us again this year. In fact, this is my second session on the Media Rumble itself. So I would just like to apologize. I have a really bad cold. I wanted to read out quite a few paragraphs from Josie's book, but I may not be able to do that. I would rather ask questions and then make him elaborate. So this is a book. I really recommend that people buy the book and read it. In fact, being a journalist who has covered at least a few of the things book, including the Indian Mujahideen and some of the arrests of the Indian Mujahideen, I was squirming reading some of the things in the book, but we'll come to that. So the book really is about the deep state, how pervasive is India's deep state, how long are the tentacles of India's security apparatus, how does it pervade into the lives of citizens, and how does the Indian security apparatus actually use Indians versus Indians? How was it, let's say, during Indira Gandhi's period, then Rajiv Gandhi, then Narendra Modi? Josie, of course, has not spared anyone, but he has very important observations to make as to what is the difference in all these things before 2014 and after 2014. So I've got a lot of questions to ask him. First thing, for those who have not read the book, I would just like to tell them that there are two parts to this book. One part looks at the Islamic terror, which is Indian Mujahideen or Lashkar-e-Taiba, the terrorists coming from Pakistan and doing the Mumbai attacks, a spate of attacks around 10 to 15 years ago. And the second part of the book looks at a bunch of incidents, like, for example, what happened in Kashmir, at the IPKF movement in Sri Lanka, and things like that. So Josie, why did you decide to make the book into two parts? The first part, of course, getting the larger chunk, becoming the bigger part of your narrative.
I mean, it's an unwieldy subject because insurgencies and terrorism has been part of the very existence of Indian state from day one, because even on the day that we became independent, the Naga rebellion had started. So how do you bring all of it into a meaningful, readable, digestible structure was the most important aspect. In fact, the book was originally written with the second part as the beginning. And the first part that you read about Wahid's story was actually the second part. But it was my editors who said, no, let's reverse it because Wahid's story is so disturbing and so detailed.
I completely agree with them. I completely agree.
So I agreed. I think I don't fight with my editor. So I said, yeah, whatever you decide. So it was just about how do you find, see, when you write, then as you know, when you write a book, especially nonfiction or even a novel, you're trying to make several arguments and several claims and several evidences through digestible, interesting, informative and engaging narrative, right? So, This is a structure that I could find out. Maybe tomorrow, maybe 6 months down the line, I may tell you, shit, man, this is not really good. I could have done it better.
So the book, again, for those who have not read the book actually, the first part of the book tells the story of a man called Wahid from Mumbai. I mean, by the time I finished reading the first part, I lost track of how many times Wahid was arrested and detained by various wings of the Mumbai police and other police systems, because they wanted him to be the accused. They wanted to implicate him in almost every terror attack which happened in the country in almost a decade. And finally, he does get implicated in the train bombings in Bombay and he gets acquitted. So it is through Wahid. Josie tells us a story of how the system works, the deep state really works. I want to read out something from page 21, Josie, where you are saying, I mean, through the first part, you establish you're someone who's tracked the intelligence systems in India very closely, but you're saying that your research and reporting tells you that Indian security establishment has a very loose system of auditing, one without any critical supervision. And as a result, Indian agencies have fake information pouring in through their vast network, which has dramatically and adversely impacted India's war on terror. So reading this book, it really surprised me. Like, for example, there are so many instances which you have given where informants would give wrong information, people would act on wrong information, or when there was right information, for example, the whole Mumbai terror attack, when there were at least six intelligence inputs saying that the attacks are going to happen, nobody acted on it. But why is that things are not changing? Or do you believe that things have changed now, at least after the Bombay attacks?
No, actually things have got worse.
Okay.
So we created, we created National Investigation Agency, NIA, to deal with national terror threats. And we wanted it to be our premier agency. But today, if you look at NIA's performance and record, it's quite embarrassing. They've become, in a decade, that agency has managed to become of almost a laughing stock. I mean, except in the minds of the people who are in government today, NIA is a laughing stock. I mean, the way they're communally trying to save certain kind of terrorists and trying to implicate certain others, and kind of the absurd claims that they keep making, etc. So it has gotten worse. And the contamination of information, meaning all intelligence security agencies in the world, their performance is directly linked to the quality of the information that comes in, right? It's like you and me. I mean, there's not very much difference between media and security agencies. Information, the quality of the information decides the output of what we do. And the contamination that started decades ago continues. And today it has reached very alarming proportions, because today the contamination is not just from bad sources. Today it's also because of political reasons.
Hmm.
So what was an apolitical activity of very incompetent people, of informants and, you know, bad information, has now been politicized too. So into the incompetence of information flow, we have added very bad politics. So now we are in complete mess. It's deep shit. So it's forget any, it's, I mean, I think we should rename the war on terror or something else, because we've communalized the entire thing.
To those listening in, Josie, how would you explain how bad is the security apparatus as when it comes to loose auditing? Because intelligence is something which is crucial to any security apparatus, right? So when you say India system is loosely audited, can you explain to those listening in why you say that?
So take an agency like CIA or MI6 or any of the intelligence agencies of the global mature democracies, and most even autocracies. When you have Mr. A as an informant supplying information X, it comes from the field, it goes to the agency, and there is a desk officer, analyst who are analyzing it. And it is filed there. They can identify who is Mr. A and what is the X information that they gave and how right was it. Now, if the agency finds, and there is regular and systematic audit of that information. Mm-hmm. If they find that Mr. A is planting wrong information, making money out of them, they will cut him off. Mm-hmm. In India, we don't have any strong audit of the information flow.
Mm-hmm.
So, which means there is no outsider looking at it. There is no expert committee auditing the information flow, nor is it accountable to parliament. See, all said and done, if you look at the American failure in Iraq, meaning the CIA was fooled by the agencies, the fact is that the fact that CIA was fooled has been held accountable and audited by at the Congress level. The congressional committees of the US government have audited it. After 9/11 attacks, if you see the 9/11 reports, investigation, it was done at a political level. And they scrutinized every piece of information. No officer, no idiot will have the courage to say that, oh, you know, this information is very sensitive, it should not be shown to the politician. Because ultimately, we are a democracy. So there is no audit of the information and audit of the quality of sources. So we have created, and probably this is the one industry where maybe then you might want to start a vertical on your side, which will be completely dedicated to this industry, this recession-proof industry called informants.
Mm-hmm.
And it's flourishing.
Yeah. So another thing that you also mentioned while speaking now, which is a continuous theme through the book, is how Indian intelligence and Indian security personnel create fake narratives. Now, whether it's communal, now throughout the Mumbai terror attacks and other terror attacks during the UPA time, you have elaborately explained how there was a lot of pressure to create fake narratives. Of course, there were a lot of Muslims who were involved in some of these terror attacks, but to incarcerate a larger number of people who had nothing to do with it, who were members of the SIMI and other organizations before those organizations became violent. So why do you think these fake narratives started in the Indian establishment and then it went on to a level? See, for example, Wahid's story. Wahid gets acquitted at one point. There are so many stories which we have heard where people get acquitted, though they were accused in cases. But like what happened in America after the Iraq war, we do not see anyone being taken to task here. Is that another problem?
Yeah, there is no accountability. Your police forces and the intelligence, to at least to a large section of the Indian population, they are mere goons, thugs, right? So there is no accounting, and there are hundreds and thousands of whites out there who are not necessarily Muslims. Islamophobia is a big part of the problem. But if you go back in time, what you see is that, we have been a nation that, it's an incomplete nationhood we had, and it's a very complex human process, Indian democracy, a very complex experiment. From very early, we have got Naga rebellion and Kashmir and this and that, Northeast, etc. But that is where the strength of a democracy or a state comes in, that you deal with the challenges without compromising yourself. You do not become like the terrorists that they're dealing with or the militant that you're fighting. But in our agencies, over the years, what has happened is that they have began to behave like the lawless criminals that they deal with. You saw what happened in Assam yesterday, right? The video. I mean, the disturbing video that came out. And mind you, the immediate response of the police force or the agencies, whoever it was to spread fake news into some of the mainstream media. So there is no accountability at all. And this lack of accountability peaks with the, let's say, 90s. Kashmir flare, and we have had, we got a bloody nose in Sri Lanka. But instead of taking the right lessons from Sri Lanka or Kashmir, we are going into the end of the millennium in a state of confusion. And then you have the Kandahar hijack. And then you have the 9/11 attacks. And that's a turning point. And then they go berserk. And then Wahids of the world are all incarcerated. And then they have no account. Nobody's questioning. They just create narratives. And if you look at attacks like the parliament attack or any of the major attacks, many of the attacks, you will find the footprints of some aspects of security agencies. So the question for a legitimate indigenous person then becomes, was some part of the state involved in the parliament attack? Was some part of the Indian state agencies involved in orchestrating the so-called Hindutva terror organization? These are very serious, legitimate questions, which people, it's not me, people at various levels have over the years raised questions, and a lot of documents prove it, that there is reason to be investigated. But we never investigated them. In fact, some of those people who should have actually been on trial for those acts have gone on to have very flourishing careers. So the first decade of this millennium after the 9/11, once George Bush gave you the most simplistic, foolish dictum saying that either you're with us or with the enemy, you go and ban SIMI, and you have a police and intelligence which has very little of deep roots within the Muslim community. They just go around, goes berserk, and you look at all the charge sheets filed in SIMI cases, they all read the same. They're all because it's cut and paste from the other. So the instead of targeting the right terrorists, they went after the wrong Muslims. Instead of arresting the right Islamic terrorists, they see. So in the decade before last, in the first decade after the millennium, you have two terrorist groups bombing your cities. And India has never seen such a phenomenon. You've got the Indian Mujahideen and the Hindutva terror group, which is bombing your cities. And what does our police and intelligence do? They are going and faking evidence against people like Wahid. They are creating fake narratives. They're questioning people like me who were reporting, saying that, look, there is something else happening. And they are silencing every critic. And instead of going after the right lead, they were going after the creating fake narratives. And we lost hundreds, we lost thousands of our citizens. My problem with this is not just about the Islamophobia or everything. My problem is also that then fundamentally, we as a state, as citizens, as responsible people, as journalists, as institutions, we owe it to those people who are grieving that they need to have closure. They should know who killed their dear ones. It cannot be the wild imagination of some idiot sitting in a police force. So from Godhra to everywhere, I'm saying there is no closure to the grieving families.
So in through the book, whether you talk about Godhra, you talk about Kashmir, Sri Lanka, Manipur, or even the terror attacks in the recent years, You have said that two major problems. One is loose auditing of India's intelligence systems, and second is the fake narratives created. Now, as a journalist, when I go to events and people ask me in English and Hindi TV media, why do they behave like this? They are also communal to a large extent. So initially, I used to think that maybe it's a revenue model. It's easier for them to get money from the government, etc. But recently, I've started to believe that it's not just about revenue. The people who run these channels believe in what they're saying. they are part of the establishment, they're part of the system, and they have those communal thoughts, I think. So what do you believe actually is a compulsion for our security apparatus to make these fake narratives? I mean, you have made a mention saying that the result of the bias is visible in administrative structures. RAW, for instance, does not employ Muslims in its ranks. The SPG excludes Sikhs. The IB, it appears to me, continues to rely heavily on interrogation reports that have been created to and manipulated by its own officers. The NIA, Mumbai attacks of 2018, also appears to have sacrificed its professionalism at the altar of political masters. So what is this big compulsion for all these officers to actually make fake narratives?
I think they are all careerists, you know. The fact is that they are in a very amoral society. If you want to have a peaceful sleep, either you have to get drunk or you have to do things that won't keep you awake in the night. And so obey the political masters, act the script that they give you, and spread this narratives that they want to hear. And you mentioned about the media. There are a few different types of journalists we have all encountered in our lives. One are those reporters, beat reporters, who are very pressed for time and who often get misled, because not that they are not good reporters, but they don't have the time, luxury of time. So they get misled by agencies, police, etc., and they go and file something wrong. But there's a second type, which is the more dangerous type, which are fairly senior people who have a luxury of time and who have got more command within their organizations, who have famous bylines, and who are willing partners in creating these narratives. So they write better English, better adjectives, all that, and they very write in very colorful language about the terror script that they want the public to read. In the process, over the decades, these people, including sometimes maybe even I may be also part of that. I may have also unwittingly committed the same mistake, but we ultimately write against some innocent guy, right? Mm-hmm. And none of the Indian media has till date ever bothered to go back on its history and say, look, we've screwed up. We made a mistake. We should have had a better auditing. Then there's a third kind, which is the one sitting on top of it, the editors and the owners. They also have a financial incentive. And I say editor and owners, they're the same in this country. I don't think there are very many independent editors left, other than in organizations like yours, which are smaller and non-legacy media organizations. In the legacy media organizations, editor is part of the management. Management has to please the political masters of the day because of the way our media is organized. See, India's biggest advertiser is the government and its agencies, right? Up to 40-50% of the revenue of most of the publications come from the government or related agencies. Now, why would the management of the day make the government unhappy and sit back without the revenue from that? And under Modi government, there is all obviously there's a very visible strategy of the government pressurizing even the private advertisers. So it's a direct loss of revenue. So it's okay if for a media baron, it's okay if I've gone to the best of the universities. I have till a decade ago use very liberal advocacy of Indian democracy. It's okay because my family heirloom, my quarterly results are protected. So some of them are communal because they just don't want to compromise their financial comforts.
And it's the same for officers also, I believe, after reading the book, for a lot of officers.
Yeah, so for the officers, it comes from the emergency era, post-emergency. They realize that it is always good to serve the master of the day. They are protected. No, but see, look at people like Jagmohan. Emergency era, he was like the face of the evil in Delhi. He went on to had a great, great life. He became a union minister under BJP. And BJP was a victim of emergency and people like Jagmohan, right? I mean, that's absurdity of Indian democracy, that officers who have served political parties and into against the opposition, even the opposition respects them and honors them. So why should the bureaucrat do anything that is to uphold the constitution? He would rather make the politician of the day happy, right?
So one part of the book which really shocked me was, I will also explain to the people watching why it shocked me, because it's about Dr. S. Malini. She used to work with the forensic science laboratory in Bengaluru. And as a reporter who covers stuff from South India, many times I have stood outside her office and her house because she is this Miss Narco, very well known, and she was all over television because of various high profile cases where she had done the narco analysis. And of course, after a certain point of time, narco analysis itself became outlawed. But there is a part in this book where you are talking about how there is an allegation that Dr. S. Malini does the narco test on Wahid, who is accused of being part of the Bombay train bombings. And then she basically asks him, so his allegation is that she asked him question like, what is a neighboring country of India? So he will say Pakistan. Or she will ask him, how many you have? Four. These are random questions, right? When the edited version comes, she will say, how many guests came to your house? Four. Which country did they come from? Pakistan. So this is how they try to implicate him. I mean, and to now, if Wahid's allegations are indeed true, what surprises me is that why did nothing happen to someone like Dr. S. Malini? How many people like this do we have in our system who have no regard for constitution, for human rights, etc.? And does that really bother you as a journalist? After reading this, it bothered me that at some point of time, I must have covered her without any filter.
Yeah, I mean, not just you, all of us have covered her without filter because for 20, 25 years, India's most sensational terror and non-terror criminal cases from Telgi stamp scam onwards, it was Malini's narco test that laid the foundation for all her reporting and court cases and judgments. And she must have done at least 1,000 narco tests, if I'm not wrong. And after she was caught out as a fraud and for forgery, I don't think any police has gone back to look at her recommendations or findings of the past. But she's not an exception. Mind you, only weeks ago, we saw the J&K police, the Kashmir police, acquitting, Devinder Singh, whose name very prominently appeared in the parliament attack case, and who was caught while accompanying a group of terrorists again to Delhi. He was to be discharged from service without an inquiry because for national interest. I mean, my national interest is not in protecting a criminal. If a criminal sitting out there, since he has power, thinks that he has a right to decide what course this country should take, then you are mistaken. In this democracy, you and I, citizens empowered with liberty, citizens empowered by the constitution, have equal right to know the truth. Truth is a foundation of a democracy. Devinder Singh has no fucking right to be acquitted like that. And you go across the country, Dinya, in Tamil Nadu, we saw that father and son being killed by police, right? How many are in jail? Right? I mean, you
that's one of the cases actually where action was taken fast because of the public outrage, I feel.
Maybe. Look at Manipur. Manipur, almost 2,000 people were killed in fake encounters. You got some 50 policemen finally on trial, but it's the wheels of justice is moving so slowly. Every landscape, in fact, if you look at India from a satellite, you could actually mark out the condos and the boundaries and cities of this country based on our torture chambers, custodial killings, and this crazy intelligence and policemen who are stamping over and the constitution on a daily basis.
But if Malini or Raghuvanshi, who was heading the ATS of Bombay, who also you speak a lot about in this book, about his ways of torturing people. And in fact, I was reading that he's now the ethics head of a cricket team, Rajasthan Royals. I mean, the man who's accused of pouring hot oil into someone is actually an ethics officer. But yes, but if a Malini or a Raghuvanshi or the killers of Benix and Jayaraj are not aberrations, as you call them, what is really the solution for us as a country? Is it only in police reforms? What should we do? Should we make more noise about it? What is the solution?
So there are there are two, three ways of looking at it. One is that we as ordinary citizens of this country, we have to speak up more. We have to be louder. We have to be screaming and shouting for justice in the public squares. That's very clear, whether as journalists or as individual journalists. Without that, there is no option, because the only thing that gets your attention is noise. The second thing is that I think citizens should mass petition the courts every time there's a human rights violation. Let's see when the courts will wake up. And there is enough history of Indian judiciary having acted in on the side of the citizen, on the side of the constitution. The third is that it is not rocket science. Then, yeah, there is the reform doable. There are replicate. multiple models out there in the West or out there in mature democracies. And there are judgments in this country. We just need to implement them. We just need to hold these buggers, whoever it is, the political masses who are remote controlling the security establishment, etc. We just need to ensure that the law is held. I think is the post-90s, the liberalization, you know, the first generation that benefited out of it. We were all busy buying our apartments and cars, you know, that some thieves gave and almost ran away with our constitution. That's what happened. And we need to recover. So you look at the power hierarchy of this country today. I mean, who are there in power? These are people who are accused of murders, or cheats, across the political spectrum, or some political princelings, or some idiot who, while in service, had messed up things, who is now given important positions. So I think we all turned our gaze away from the constitution and we are paying the price for it. And we took our eyes off what our parents, our grandparents achieved. We took for granted what the Gandhian generation achieved, which was to create the world's largest, most complex democratic process ever, experiment ever. We thought it's there forever. No, it's, and that's what my book is trying to argue.
You have been very scathing about Rajiv Gandhi and what happened, at least in two instances. One is the rigging of the Kashmir election in 1987, and almost simultaneously what happened in Sri Lanka when Rajiv Gandhi takes his decision of sending IPK, just blows on his face, and finally, of course, he's assassinated. How crucial, you say that we turned our attention to the constitution, right? How crucial do you think that time period was? I mean, in India's decay, really, what happened in 1987-88 during Rajiv Gandhi's times? And why did you choose those two instances?
We should go a bit backward into the 70s. Let's say, I don't know if there is a political family in the world, in the human history, which has nurtured terrorists who will end up killing their own family members. Meaning, both Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi were assassinated by terrorists that they nurtured. I'm sorry to say this, that's a fact of it. So Gandhi family has paid terrible price for their misplaced notions. LTT was created, armed and trained by Indira Gandhi. Let's be honest about it. Rajiv Gandhi and Kashmir and that LTT is what finally brings down, takes Rajiv Gandhi, assassinates Rajiv Gandhi. The Sikh terrorists were... Bindranwale was selected and created by the Congress. And he and his men finally ends up finishing off Indira Gandhi, right? It's a very crazy story. I mean, I don't know any other family in the world which would have had to pay such dearly for their misplaced notions of power. Now, if you look at Rajiv Gandhi, there are a lot of great things to talk about Rajiv Gandhi, but my lens of this book was purely through the security framework of things. If you look at Kashmir, Sheikh Abdullah Indira Accord happens. And if you look that period after the late 70s and 80s, early 80s, Kashmir actually had a relatively peaceful democratic period. And then Congress started moving the chess pieces on Kashmir board, which peaks with 1987 state assembly elections, where Farooq Abdullah and Rajiv Gandhi joins hands. And the rigging is beyond belief. You saw what I mean. It's unbelievable. You know, some accepted his laws and gone back to bed. Usko bula ke, he's called back saying that you are the winner now. You know, go become the MLA. I mean, there are phone calls coming saying that the Muslim United Front candidates can't be the winners. So the present day, including the Mr. Gilani, who passed away a few days ago, and the Hizbul Mujahideen chief commander, the chief, Syed Salahuddin, etc. They were all active participants in the 1987 elections. It was a generation of Kashmiris who believed in our democratic process, who were humiliated, thrashed, jailed, and abused, who and then became militants. I mean, should it be surprising to a sane human being? So, and then Rajiv Gandhi is relentless because a young, energetic prime minister, right? He then thinks that he can bring peace to Sri Lanka. Actually, he and Prabhakaran have a very short-lived friendship where Prabhakaran is in Delhi, Rajiv Gandhi makes his son Rahul bring his bulletproof jacket, which is gifted to Prabhakaran. Prabhakaran takes a jacket and goes back. And before Prabhakaran lands in Sri Lanka, you already have the Indian peacekeeping force with some tourist map thinking that they are going to be bringing peace. They are told that these are our boys, you know, don't worry about the Tamil militants. Without paying attention to the repeated assault on the dignity of the Sri Lankan Tamils done by the Sri Lankan government over the years, and the anger that was dammed in there. You go in within, by the third month, as you know, the LTT and IPK turned bitter enemies. And Rajiv sends the words, one of the most powerful militaries, on one of the most unbelievable operations to capture Prabhakaran. And it ends in disaster. Prabhakaran escapes and he plots back and gets Rajiv Gandhi, right? So in the 80s, the period that you pointed out, late 80s, that period is very crucial. And to understand how political masters who manipulate our security intelligence apparatus ends up ruining democracy for some people, if not all the people. And that's what's happening again.
Okay, now before we come to the present period, I'll just talk a little bit about the Manmohan Singh era, which is not discussed too much, but yes, you do go into Salwa Judam. And you also say that, India is one country where continuously governments have tried to turn its people against its own people. Small militias, or you make, within one state itself, you make different groups. So that strategy has not worked out for India in many states. But why do we continuously employ that?
One step back, Manmohan Singh period is when Wahid actually goes through the trial. So
correct.
It's not that I spared him anyway. So what has happened is that Indian political class, political leadership, gave up the responsibility of building a mature democracy long ago. Maybe with emergency or whatever. And it is the bureaucrats, the technocrats, the policemen who are deciding our policy actually. And what do these people do? Someone goes to Ireland, someone goes to Latin America and says, oh, okay, you can form militias by the people. Let me go and form militia. So you create the Ikhwanis in Kashmir, you create militias in, and you arm the Salwa Judam, and you set your people to kill each other. That's not democracy. This is crude autocracy. But our politicians don't have the time, they don't understand. Third, they don't want to piss off the police or the Indian lines because these are the people who are going to do the dirty job for them when they want it. Right? So they're all in it together. Whatever the public statement they might make, they're all in it together. And they set people against each other. Cousins kill cousins. And we become a civilization which eats its own children, simply put. And you look at the ruin that has caused, that policy has caused across the landscape.
So you also mentioned, okay, of course, I was talking about the second part of the book where you go more into Rajiv Gandhi, and the first part of the book is completely dedicated to Manmohan Singh and Narendra Modi regimes. You also say in between, there's a one line you sneaked in between, I have a doubt on that. You said 2011 to 2014, the CBI, ED and other agents. Why did you say that?
No, I said that because statistically and factually, if you look at it, when the India Against Corruption begins, takes off, Supreme Court is actually very empowered. If you remember the judgments and the control and the court-monitored, supervised investigations, and CBI and ED were all doing the right job of investigating the masters in power, investigating the big crime, corruption, following the big cases where country has lost the most. Not like today. Today, income taxes after people like you and Abhinandan and everybody in the world. I don't know whether they're looking.
They send notice every 2 weeks.
So, yeah, I mean, that's what I mean. So, because for them, you are giving the time, not the four funds in Mauritius, which has propped up Adani to a certain level. And the same funds have played crucial role in subverting and collapse of some of India's biggest bank loan defaulters. No, that doesn't matter. The near Rajendran Abhinandan Sikri matters because you people talk the truth, speak truth to a government which believes in propaganda, which is uncomfortable and which doesn't mind lying, right? So they're serving the masters. They are not serving the democracy. They are also equal threats to Indian democracy. Because there is a very serious threat to Indian economy from some of these large funds there are these corporations who have over invoice electricity equipment. Those who have imported bad quality coal, which is burned to produce electricity, and because of which our pollution and electricity rates have gone up. None of it matters to these people. They don't have time. They have time for you and news laundries and of the world. So serving the political master of the day is what gives them peaceful night. That's what matters to them. And it's actually sometimes when you look at it, it's very embarrassing because some of our brightest people get through UPSC exam. You meet them, and I've been to the IRS Academy and other places. Very smart people here, very smart, very good, committed people. But the pressures of life, the ambitions of career, all of it makes them into mere goons and won't hire, it's just that we pay the salary for them to harass us. That's the difference. Because a political master doesn't pay them the salary.
Okay, now we'll go into the Narendra Modi period before, let's see if any questions come in. Now, in the book, you have spoken about the Gujarat riots, of course, the Godhra train burning before that, then the Gujarat riots. And you have sort of established that what Narendra Modi did in Gujarat, from Godhra to Gujarat riots and the Harin Pandya killings and, the fake narrative, that the entire system has now been co-opted at a national level. Could you elaborate on that?
See, in many ways, Narendra Modi is a product of the post 9/11 world, because he finished off Gujarat a few weeks after, it's a month after, I think, 9/11 attacks. And he's a very clever politician. He understands the world has changed and there are happens, which is one of the most tragic things to have happened in India in a long time. About 60 people being burned to death in a train. I think it's very tragic. It's like the Bagan tragedy or maybe worse than that. He lands up in Godhra. Until then, the district collector, the police officers, even Vajpayee in parliament, they all say that it looks like an accident. There is no indication there was a grand conspiracy. Whatever. He lands up in Godhra. Terrorism. This is a conspiracy. This is a pre-planned attack. And from then on, he and everyone that he picks on is trying to prove that it was a conspiracy. Before that, he obviously orders the state district administration to hand over all the dead bodies to VHP leaders who take it to Ahmedabad to instigate the riots, which in itself was illegal because I don't think Indian laws allow you to hand over dead bodies to any Tom, Dick and Harry. And I don't know why nobody has ever questioned Mr. Modi for that order or that act. Now, who does he bring in to investigate Godhra? In Chapel, Rakesh Astana, I guess, officer, who has whose charge sheet in Godhra case has been shredded to pieces by the trial court. The key conspirator that he named, some Chapel Murji, has been acquitted by the court. The court has shredded that, and court has convicted some of them, but has shredded the charge sheet, saying that there is no grand conspiracy. There's a proof of it. I mean, most of the key claims have collapsed. But that doesn't affect the life and career of the police officer, Rakesh Astana, who goes on to have great post. And it turns out much later that his daughter's wedding was hosted by Sandhya Sira family, who have ran away from India after taking out 15,000 crore rupees of bank loans. None of it matters. And Rakesh Astana goes on to have a glorious career. And Modi government goes overboard to protect and promote him. And he is now the police chief of this city, Delhi. Mm-hmm. Now, then onwards, after that, you have a procession of fake encounters. And this is not what activists or you and I are claiming. This is what Gujarat police or CBI or judicial commissions, including Supreme Court appointed committees, have said over and again that almost all of those major encounters are fake. But all those fake encounters had one common theme in running, which is that they were coming to assassinate Narendra Modi or some other important political leader of BJP or VHP, mostly Narendra Modi. And DG Vansara is a star through all of it. He wrote a confessional.
This is the same story repeating now. You're saying the entire pattern is getting repeated now.
Yeah. I mean, and it is not just in Bhima Koregaon. In Bhima Koregaon, again, they have created a narrative of urban Naxals or whatever shit they want to call it, of having a group of some of our finest citizens, some of the people who have given up their lives for this country, they've all been bracketed into a terror group who are trying to assassinate who? Narendra Modi, right? And there, it is now by now proven that it was a state-sponsored conspiracy to implicate them, because a weapon like Pegasus was deployed against many of them. Evidence were planted on their computers, and they created the narrative. And in my book, if you recall, it's not just about Bhima Koragav. I've also documented another case in Ranchi where they tried to create a similar narrative, but which fell flat on its face, where they tried to implicate another Muslim for coming to assassinate Narendra Modi. So there is a pattern to it. I don't know whether it is Narendra Modi himself enjoying this fact of being a victim of, potential victim of suicide attacks, or is he creating his own image, or is it that he has no clue about it? And the police officers and intelligence operatives out there know that Modi enjoys his attention and are creating it repeatedly, as if the entire society, we are all fools. I mean, it almost to me feels like we are a society of dumb herds who have to believe this. You know, in the morning, get up and say, look, our leader is under threat. And in each of these cases, there is repeated evidence. So I think we are a banana republic. If we were a democracy, there would have been serious investigation. People would have been in jail implicated. I mean, there were some who went to jail and then they get acquitted. So Narendra Modi at Gujarat, what he did was Gujarat police, like all state police, are already in a bad shape, unprofessional. Under him, that police force just went to dogs. And now he comes to center. And you look at the way the Modi regime has been exploiting, misusing the CBI, the Enforcement Directorate, the income tax, and every other arm of the state. You know, there is an intelligence report saying that, the NGOs in this country are causing some 2% loss of GDP. Hmm. Man, the government has brought down the GDP dramatically. It's not the NGOs which brought down. It's a Modi government which brought down. Why don't you write a report about that? So we got this puppets out there, and we are in this Dala land where all kinds of reports have been created. And as I said, the overstressed income tax department, which is struggling to find revenues for the country in an economy that is collapsing, is spending hours sending notice to the News Minute and news laundries of the world. I mean, that there must be something really drastically wrong with those offices. Even if the bosses tell you, you should have some common sense saying that, boss, my country's economy is in doldrums. Let me recover as much money from those big rascals. Let me not waste time on this.
I ask the question almost on a daily basis. So a couple of questions coming. Two questions I'm very partial to because I want to ask them myself. Therefore, I will read out those first. First is from Raghunath Mandal. In fact, Mr. Raghunath, I was telling Josie this before we started the discussion. So Raghunath is asking, I really like the book. How can people be more attentive to details in such piece of reality? And can you elaborate the IPKF's endeavor in Sri Lanka and anything else you want to add? So I had asked Josie before the session began that in the book, why did you not speak about, like, I'm someone who covered a little bit of the LTT, at least 1 or 2 years from Tamil Nadu during the last leg of the civil war. And what I had learned at that time is that the RAW was also sympathetic to the LTT in many ways because they trained them, which is why their intelligence was not exactly good, or rather their intelligence was skewed. The entire intelligence, in fact, was skewed, which led to the big, colossal loss for the IPKF. So is there anything that you want to add apart from what's in the book and, of course, this whole point of India's intelligence failing in the IPKF mission?
See, IPKF, the LTT was a great classic example for the Indian security establishment to realize one fundamental thing, which was that terrorism, every religion throughout history has been used and misused for violent means, whether it's Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, whatever, every religion. So we should have drawn those fundamental lessons. Number two, we should have drawn the equally important lesson that whether it's an RNAW or IB, if you let them loose, they will create monsters for you. They need to be democratically controlled, which did not happen. The third was that, and which went today and forever in human history or in our future, is that people, all kinds of people, literate, illiterate, whatever, they all have a sense of dignity. Do not breach their dignity repeatedly. And that's what the present government is doing. they will react. They will react in violent, unimaginable fashions. That's what history has taught us. That's what the future holds. Do not think that you can suppress a society or a certain community. Muslims, whoever you want to call it, Dalits, whatever you want to call it, the Christians or Hindus, whatever. Do not do it. You might gain some votes for the immediate, but you are creating a future that is disastrous for our children. So IPK, FLTT, there's a lot of lessons to be drawn. None of it was drawn, and we are paying for it even today.
Basically, India did not understand the local sentiments, the sentiments which Tamils in India had towards the LTT, and many other things went wrong. Now I'll go to Ayush Yadav's question again, a question I wanted to ask. So he's saying, in your book, you talked about the phenomenon of terror emanating from Hindu nationalism and how our intelligence agencies get cold feet in investigating them. How does this compare to America, where in recent times the rise of white nationalism with the rise of Trump has actually set off the opposite response of their security establishment? So that is his question. My question is a bit different. My question is, in your book, you have written about how even before 2014, when the Congress, when the UPA was in power also, there were many indications during terror attacks that there were connections to Hindu groups, especially emanating from Indore, Thakur, etc. But the agencies did not want to investigate, though it was not the BJP in power at the union at that time. So his question is, of course, in comparison to America, mine is, why do they continuously develop cold feet no matter who's in power?
So to Ayush's question, all democracies will do that. If there's a threat to... it's very easy to distinguish between threat and non-threat, right? Between right and wrong. So if in a democracy, when you know something is a threat, you take action against it. That's what the FBI and others have done in the US. I mean, they went gone after the whites in a very aggressive fashion. And that's what everybody should do. Every agency should do. And we did not do it because... The second part of the question, which you said, which is that irrespective of who is in power, these agencies have largely become anti-Muslim, Islamophobic because of 30 years of Kashmir engagement, because of the lack of enough Muslims in the ranks, and because of maybe political reason, but also because probably that what we saw as the most organized Hindutva terror organization, the Bharat, the Kanal Purohit and what are the gangs, probably it was a state creation. There is enough in it. It should have been investigated. Nobody bothered to find out who created the Abhinav Bharat. Hmm. Where did they get RDX from? RDX did not go from army definitely not from army. Colonel Purohit did not get RDX from the army. So I am saying that there is much more sinister side to the Indian security establishment than we are willing to acknowledge.
There is a question from Nandan Lathwal. He's asking, what you said, a lot of brilliant, bright people join the services. He's saying, he wonders how and where they lose their spine.
I don't know. I wish I had the answer. But I think, as you grow in your 20s and in your 30s, so most of the young officers that you meet in service, they are very idealistic and very people. But as they move into their 30s and 40s, the family pressures, the demands for children, the ambitions of having good vacations, a lot of things play into it. And they lose the plot. Also, mind you, in government, careerism is a 40-year-old run, right? Your career is over 30, 40 years. You have to be on the right side of the powers that be for 3-4 decades. Then only you can reach the top. It's not like you and me. I've changed 8 jobs maybe.
You speak of your friend who used to get negative remarks from the army because he would not stand by false encounters.
Yeah. Brigadier Pramod, he passed away, poor chap, because of cancer. He was asked to stage an encounter, which he refused to do. And from that day, he kept in negative remarks from the brigadier who ordered the fake encounter after Chitti Singh Pura. I'm talking about a matter of few months. My friend first refuses to do a fake encounter. Few months later, Chitti Singh Pura massacre happens. A few days later, they stage that shameful fake encounter of some poor villagers saying that they were the terrorists began Chitti Singh Pura. They're proved innocent later. the brigadier and others are still, I think, out there in, I don't think they're in jail or anything. But my friend paid with his career. And a lot of people, a lot of officers who have refused to be bloodthirsty have paid with their careers.
So to just answer Mr. Nandan's question, it's not just about losing your spine. Basically, the system rewards people who go with the flow, who are ready to create fake narratives, etc. So we are going to wrap the session up now with one final question. I'm going to read out one line, two lines that many political movements around the world mainstream themselves by shedding their violent fringes. But the BJP and its larger ecosystem have failed to do that. In fact, under Modi, the party has actively encouraged such elements, most visibly in its nomination of Pragya Singh Thakur to the Bhopal Lok Sabha constituency. The reticence of the BJP to fully commit itself to peaceful democratic means and to shedding or disciplining its fringe elements will cost both the party and Indian democracy dearly. What is your thoughts about the immediate future of this country? And with that, we'll wrap.
No, I think we are in a very serious critical juncture, which India has never seen, maybe never after 1970s, after the Indian emergency. We could very well slip into a majoritarian state with the strife, huge strife, chaos, a chaotic majoritarian state. We won't be peaceful. That's a very high likelihood, because I don't think the present era of politics is going to end in a very or give way to a new one in a peaceful manner, and in that transition phase we will have a lot of violence. So we are going to witness a lot of violence and bloodshed. There is very likelihood, there is a good chance that we might lose democracy, but I hope the spineless intelligence and the police officers and the income tax officers of the country will all stand up and realize that if not for themselves, at least for their children, they need to stand up on the right side of law. And that's only hope we can have.
Well, that's kind of ominous, but let's not lose hope. Thank you very much, Josie, and do buy the book and read it.